Adeline. Written by Jared Neely. Publication July 7, 2015. The Midnight Horror Junkies. Middletown, Pennsylvania Self-Publishing Agency. Psychnosis. Adeline, a 12-year-old girl transitioning into a charming three-storied colonial, becomes intrigued with the history buried there. Decrepit secrets and a sinister past menace the family of three: Adeline, her expecting mother, and her hard-nosed father fighting the endless temptation of alcoholism. Endless acres of countryside stretch out along the home where Adeline finds that the beauty of the old colonial has more to it than what meets the eye. Some secrets buried deep in darkness need to stay dead, and others need to find light any way they can. Chapter 1, A Window Open is a Window Shut. The colonial was built near the end of the 18th century and showed its aging signs caused by its intangible past. From the outside it glistened in the lustrous sunshine barreling down at it, but with all of its beauty something whispered in the open air of infectious dormant. What it was concealed deep inside, and the fellers who had just moved in were blinded of its dying need of breaking free. The colonial was a place that stood on an incline where the ground had raised over time. Since then the previous owners had built a stairwell leading up to it made of blocks of grayish sandstone. They curved slightly at the entrance and straightened facing the upper level on the first floor. Fragments of stone had crumbled within its structure and fell along the steps leading upwards. Surprisingly, its craftsmanship had held up through many rough winters. The front of the old colonial standing true towered in the sunlight, a mixture of red and white brick. Patiently awaiting a family, and it had finally come, as if it were opening its doors for a final confrontation, a death-dealing confrontation between the will of the living and its surging barbarous antiquity. Adeline was playing along the rickety oak floorboards, lying against it clutching a plastic Victorian doll as she spoke as if it were alive. "Would you happen to like some tea, madam?" she queried, holding them in both hands. "Of course I'd love some." The yellowed-haired doll facing the other spoke abruptly. Adeline Mayfeller changed her voice as it crackled, sounding of an elderly woman. "I'll pour you a smidge and bring you a piece of custard pie," she politely answered back, wiggling the two dolls around in her hands as she continued to play. She was alone upstairs. She had only been playing for a short moment. Picking the room as hers, she decided to declare it before anyone else. It was old-fashioned and the air smelled stale, but she admired the view. The sunshine was shining in from two windows on the opposite wall of the doorway. Along the bottom of them was a place to sit. Old wood overstretched both window sills, giving the view a place to sit and take in the country scenery. The property was once a vacation home for the previous owners, Evelyn and Gudrun, her husband of 38 years. Without any explanation of why they hauled out of town, 2 years prior they had speed out of state without as much as a word. Abandoning the colonial, leaving it as it stood, the fellers picked it up on a keen offer they couldn't refuse. The realtor almost threw them the keys, which made it all the merrier for them to hurry in and make it their home. Adeline continued to impersonate the senior woman's voice, pouring invisible tea into tiny cups sitting on miniature saucers. She continued motioning the dolls as if they were living a life there as well, prancing the yellowed-haired doll around a small table her grandmother had once owned when she was a child. Both of her parents were down below on the first floor unpacking the cluttered hauling van her father had almost unwillingly borrowed from work. It wasn't a traditional thing for him to borrow it, but the senior president at the Fuller's Brothers Company in Portsmouth had insisted on him taking it home instead of hammering himself with endless trips back and forth to Darbsey. Darbsey was in the same state, about a 2.5-hour travel from their new two-storied home, if you weren't counting the attic. Wyoming was home for the family of three and one on the verge of being born. Adeline's mother was pregnant and due to conceive her daughter's baby sister within the next month. She appeared overjoyed about it. She was high on the thought of being the older sister. Having a younger sibling would definitely give her someone else to play with other than Ruthie and Disha. Those were her vintage dolls, her favorite toys out of a small collection. Adeline peered at her dolls standing them on the hardwood just beside the tiny table holding the teacups. "Let's adventure back downstairs and see what Mom and Dad's up to," she said while gripping Ruthie and Dershi tightly against her. Stumbling down the second floor steps, she reached the bottom floor where her feet suddenly stomped against the old wood. She stopped in her own shadow, staring at the doorway her father had left it open. She could see him in the far distance. He was approaching her, clutching a heavy box piled with junk. The heavy load of odds and ends were blocking him from seeing her ahead, as he traced the stairs carefully with every step. Nearing her, stepping onto the steps leading back up, he suddenly caught a glimpse of her as the box shuffled, almost flipping over and out of his grasp before he could manage it. "Oh hey, I almost didn't see you up there," he said, shuffling the box and its contents back in order. "Why don't you go help your mother? She's in the cellar. I'm sure she could use your help now that you're going to be a big sister," he said. Adeline was unable to see his facial expressions as he got closer to the top. His voice was soft as she stood in thought, wondering about her new room. She stood still, standing in the doorway with the door propped open against the hinge stopper. "I'll go check on her," she said, turning around, heading in the direction of the kitchen. That's where she had noticed the cellar when they first scoped the house out before the loan went through. Waiting for the loan seemed like eternity for her as she became anxiously overwhelmed. She was grateful for the move, a new school and a massive property that stretched acres out into the bright daylight. It was all a fairy tale come true, and now she'd be living in it. Things couldn't have gone any easier in her part. Adeline sat in her room. She had come up after her mother, Julia, and she had dropped a lofty load of dirty clothing into the washer down below in the musty cellar. Her father Dick Feller was still bringing in bushels of baskets her mother had packed away since her college graduation party at the Ella's Painting Institution back in Darbsey. Julia Feller was conservative and held on to the stockpile of the brushes she had used on her paintings. It was almost ritualistic in an odd way. The attic was planned out to become her studio area now that they had extra space. Until then, her paintings would lean against the old brick wall in the cellar, covered over in plastic sheeting. Vintage floral wallpaper covered all corners of Adeline's new bedroom. A floral design unlike any she had seen in her short lifespan. Her eyes gazed at it as she pushed Dasha along the wooden planks, straddling a mini plastic 1965 Massey. Pulling the lightly blue-painted tractor up beside Ruthie, flinging her off as it stopped abruptly. "Oh my goodness, darling, is you all right? Looks as if that gosh pickin' machine we got away from you." She spoke using the same elderly woman's voice as earlier, using her Victorian doll she self-named as Ruthie. "Sure did, hadn't run it since Bert Silver's left for the war," she replied, swiftly gripping Dasha from the hard floor, standing her up with a slight limp. "Legs gonna be hurtin', but a farming girl's got to be a hard worker these days." Adeline Mayfeller continued speaking with her best southern voice. Her tiny vocal cords sounded scratchy, clearing them as she spoke to her dolls. From the corner of the room, a human-like shadow flickered swiftly behind her, catching her eyes as it reflected against the glass windows not far in front of her. The surprising quickness of the unexpected reflection was much too fast for her young eyes as she turned in astonishment. Adeline's eyes stuck fast against the wall behind her, screwing her upper body in its direction momentarily. Her eyes gazed at the crinkling paper as it bubbled over the years since being glued. The wallpapering was mesmerizing as she outlined its detail with her dark brown eyes and growing pupils. Every inch of her new room seemed to establish another gift for her as she turned her attention back towards her dolls now left lying in front of her. "Dasha, come over after you're finished with plowing and baling and keep this lonely old madam company. I'll have more herbal tea poured for us and some leeches to put on your injury, my dear," she cried, holding Ruthie tightly in her fist. "Ruthie, my love, you're truly a blessing. Leeches, I got to love y'all for that sense of humor you sure do have," Adeline said, replying in the off-pitched voice of a hard-working southerner. A sudden tromping sound approached her coming up the stairway leading to her room just off-center from the top step. Her door was shut behind her as she turned, awaiting either her mother or father to enter into the room to put her to bed. Adeline's eyes fixated at the door, now clutching both dolls against her chest. The steps creaked and popped underneath them as the footsteps reached midway towards her room and then stopped abruptly. She listened for it as if she was being secretly monitored, but the silence from behind the door grew unusually quieter almost eerily as she unknowingly awaited a familiar voice to call in for her. The heavy wooden door with the brass C-shaped handle didn't budge, staring innocently at it. Just as she turned away, almost leaving the noise and forgetting it altogether, a sudden tapping pattered against the outside. It came in sequences as she listened patiently for her parents to jump out from behind it, in a non-funny attempt at a game. Her face brightened as she watched, waiting to burst into uncontrollable laughter, almost holding it in for the perfect second of anticipation. She placed the dolls along the floor, holding her mouth tightly in her tiny fingers, staring at the noise. It continued to tap and then pause and then tap again, as her adolescent mind began to question which one of her parents were out to trick her into opening it. Until that moment she hadn't remembered closing the large door, but it was shut. Still holding her sealed lips tightly in her palm, she slowly raised from the parquet flooring underneath her. Quietly creeping towards the awkward pattering against the solid door, her eyes were stretched apart and burning in curiosity. The room had become death-like and carried a tasteless odor as she noticed it culminating around her as she approached the door. Slightly clasping her fingers around the brass handle, she cautiously tugged onto it. Pulling it cowardly towards her, she pushed the button underneath it to release it from the framing as it squealed, breaking open an inch as she gripped the handle, peering out through the slight opening. Adeline May's eyes glued outwards but could only see the banister wrapping around the lengthy stairway. Being brave, she forcefully pushed the door open, hastily stumbling backwards in a ditch attempt of getting her nerves worked up by her parents' disturbing attempt at playfully putting her down for the night. The heaviness of it slammed against the outer wall, sending a skeletal echo through the second floor hallway. She stood lost and puzzled, and her mind was running away as she glared forward into the dark. Neither of her parents jumped at the chance, as she froze just a moment. Wondering to herself inside her confused mind if it wasn't over, walking sockless towards the vast doorway. An unusual coldness filled her toes from the floor beneath her as she crept again and towards the outside of her illustrious room. "Mom, Dad!" she cried, as her face began growing fearful. Her hand left her face as she tightly gripped it into a fist. Both of her hands were joggling and shivering in front of her. There weren't any lights on in the upper hallway as she peered out into the shady floor. Down below there was two large rectangular windows in the parlor room, but light didn't cast very well at night from them. The farmland outside of their newly purchased colonial was for the most part flat, after getting down the incline leading up to its massive pillars. It was nearly past 7 and the night had already ink-blotched over the entire forefront of the home. Adeline was shivering in a dreamlike daze as she reached the hallway finally. Peering from the side to side, the hallway as well as her parents' room was vacant and left as it were. The sudden feeling of isolation filled her as she cried out for one of them. "Mom, Dad!" she began shouting into the darkness. Her voice carried through the hollow space filling the upstairs. Her parents' room was to the right side of hers, but it was empty. Nobody answered back as she stood stiffly in the narrow hallway listening for them. A slight wind calmly circled around her bare toes. The bitter air breezed out from the nostalgic room behind her and appeared to follow her standing close to the banister. The old red and white brick colonial was drafty and held an unusual smell. The scent of rotten lilacs filtered through the openness of the vast home. Adeline lowered her fists and released her fingers, laying them against the banister built along the stairwell of the second floor. Adeline lowered her head, peering downwards into the first floor, but could only see the outline of the heavy storm door and a tiny glimmer of moonlight shining in. The weak light shined in from the two windows perpendicular on both sides of it. Adeline raised her head as she turned towards the stairwell and crept down one step at a time. They began clamoring, the identical noise she had witnessed earlier upstairs. With every soft step, the wood began freakishly groaning underneath her soft feet as it cracked and hissed. Adeline May finally hit the floor at the bottom as she made her way to the front entrance. She heard her parents chattering outside as she gripped the corroded knob in front of her. Unsuspectingly, the hideous door swung open with her mother peering at her and the doorway. "Adeline May, is everything all right?" But before she could reply, a blankness swept over her as she stared back. Your father and I were just sitting on the stone stairs along the front of the house enjoying the warm night. Both of us were just chatting about how well you've been adjusting here. Adeline glared at her as she turned her attention to the doorway, also noticing how warm the air coming in from the night felt as it hit her face. Her mother was clutching her neck in her hands from behind. Adeline was still staring at her as she watched her mother. "Everything's fine. I was just startled, that's all," she said, noticing a jovial smile across her mother's warm face. It had been a long while since she'd seen her mother at peace like she was. It was a breath of fresh air seeing her that way, and she hoped inside it would stay. "What's up with your neck? Are you okay, Mom?" she asked, thoughtfully becoming concerned over her. "Yes, I'm just a bit fatigued. Today has been a bit rough on your mother's old bones. I'm not your age anymore, honey," she answered back as the two paused in the doorway. They both delayed the conversation when a sudden grunt came from outside not far from them. Adeline's father had risen up from his sitting spot to see what the two were up to. "Hey, champ," he said, stooping inside the front door, then slowly trudging in beside both of them. The cumbersome storm door was hanging abroad as all three gazed instantaneously out at the flat land in the distance. Suddenly, Adeline fought the thickness of the night shielding the massive farm as her eyes astoundingly caught a condemned stable leaning halfway over many yards out. "What is that out there on the far right of the field?" she asked. Her eyes were slimmed and were still trying hard to figure out what it was she had somehow missed earlier. "It was originally a horse stable, from what I learned from the realtor," her father replied, leaning against the heavily painted framework along the door. "The previous owner had used it as a chicken coop." He paused a moment as he yawned. Both of the girls were now glaring outwards into the pitch black. He then began again, pointing to it while holding the frame of the doorway as a crutch. "From what I can tell, it's not particularly safe to be inside, so keep away from it, okay, champ?" he said, now scratching his chin. He appeared serious as he turned his face towards the two standing still watching the shady night. Adeline stood waiting for another moment, feeling safer than she had a moment before upstairs. "Well, Ade, you know what time it is," said her mother, grabbing her gently against her shoulder, steering her towards the stairs leading up to the upper level. Adeline turned for a brisk moment at her and then back towards the high stair. "Well, I figured it was bedtime," she said, sluggishly dragging her bare feet ahead of her. The next morning, Adeline woke underneath her hefty goose-feathered comforter. The summer sunshine was already heating her face as she laid another moment, finally opening her eyes to see her new bedroom around her. It was early, maybe 6:30. Well, it felt that way to her. Although her parents were still asleep, she was eager to see more of the house after learning about the abandoned horse stable her father warned her not to go in. Most of her clothing was still in boxes and jacked up to the ceiling from the move a day earlier. A couple unmarked ones were in her reach as she leaped from her bed and jogged excitingly towards them. Adeline continued by tearing the tape holding the signs together, reaching and pulling out a handful of her unsorted summer outfits. Pulling on a worn pair of jeans and a butterfly tank top, she hastily tread towards the closet on the left corner of her room. Her mother had put her midsize collection of shoes inside when they first arrived. Opening the grizzled door, it swung open, revealing her shoes lined up top of an old cedar chest. Adeline sat along the floor, pulling on the first open-toed shoe she could find. As she fought to get it onto her sweaty foot, her eyes bent back towards the cedar box inside. It didn't appear to be hers. She'd never seen it before the move. The unfamiliar box was the size of a blanket chest and it had an unusual painting covering it. It was oil brushed horizontally along the front, which appeared to be done many years ago. A meadow stretched across the chest's outer side, as well as a flock of roosters pecking seed from the soil. The painting had a unique signature across the lower corner, but it was unreadable to Adeline and had worn down since then. Becoming intrigued with it, she placed her other shoe on and leaned into the gloomy closet. Adeline hoisted the shoes off one by one and piled them to her side as she grabbed hold of the mysterious rectangular styled chest. She snagged it in both hands, gripping them along its sides, and pulled it along the floor until it reached the center of the room. Dust circled her face as it resonated from the box below her, causing her eyes to begin to water. "Filthy box," she whispered mutely to herself as she examined the outside before looking in. The roosters and the meadow were perfectly detailed, even more so in the light. The sun outside was becoming warmer as it hit her shoulder. She glared at the chest lying there along the wooden floorboards a moment. It somehow reminded her of her great-grandmother Nina. Adeline was just a tiny 2-year-old girl when she passed, but she had flashes of memory of her and her home. The smell of it also reminded her of her lilacs. Suddenly, before she could lift the lengthy lid, the noise of children playing came from outside. Adeline darted for the window seals located in the back of her room to see who it was. Arriving at the glass, her face peeked outwards as she peered down at the field below. At first she couldn't see anyone. The field was green and filled with poppies and other wild flowers. Her eyes traced the land as she peered out even further in hopes of seeing the horse stable. At first it was almost invisible in the far distance as her eyes met the crumbling barn-like building. It was acres out from the house as she gazed from behind the old glass. She could see the shingled roof leaning from it and wild spring flowers almost growing over, hiding it from the world. Just before Adeline could turn back towards the chest in the center of her room, unwittingly, another sound came from below the house. She peered out again, noticing a young girl around her age running through the field of white and yellow wild spring growth. Adeline's eyes widened as she glared at her from above. She began tapping on the hard glass using her knuckles to get her attention from the outside. The young girl from outside ran speedily through the field, heading in the opposite direction, unwanting to turn around. Adeline stared from the glass in curiosity of her as she turned, peering down at the cedar box, leaving it there with no hesitation. She bolted down the old stairwell and gripped the knob of the front door and treaded out towards where she had seen her. Running through the poppies and white and yellow wild weeds sprouting almost everywhere under the summer heat. Her eyes fixed along the back of the field where she assumed the girl had run. Her shoes caught along the uprooted weeds as she neared the open field. Chapter 2, The Smell of Lilacs. Adeline stopped running because her chest was racing. She peered further out into the warm air, but the little girl she had seen wasn't anywhere to be found. A moment later she continued slowly towards the horse stable about an acre from her and the field. As she approached the stable she realized how deserted she felt, that far from her parents' new property. She had crossed the field many acres out and stood now only a few yards from the crumbling stable her father demanded her to stay out of. When she reached the front of it she could feel her face sweating as she peered inwards through an opening where a door would have been. Inside it was pitch dark and held no light, there wasn't any window on the outside. Her father's warning to stay away echoed inside her mind as she leaned near it. On her knees she bent down to get closer to the inside, where a middle-sized pile of dry hay was sprawled across the ground. The hair along the back of her neck rose without her realizing it, as she glared in. "Come inside, Ade," whispered a faint, unrestrained voice. Adeline was paralyzed in fear of the horrifying voice, falling back from the dark opening. Her hands shook in panic as she turned hastily and sprinted towards her parents' colonial acres away. Thoughts crossed her young imagination as she darted through the open field of wild weeds and dried dirt. The grim voice echoed in her ears as she ran for the stairs made of old sandstone. Confused by it, was it the uncanny voice of the young girl she had seen a short while ago upstairs in the window? She wondered hopelessly as she reached the first step up. A moment after she reached the top of the porch where the stairs ended, she turned back to peer at the stable far away in the sunlight. The rickety horse stable would forever leave an impression on her. Suddenly, she could feel pain coming from her lower calves as she knelt down to check the back of her legs. As she did, her stomach went numb at the sight of 3 bloody scratches deeply gouged into her. Both of her legs were bleeding and dripping as she stopped again to peer back into the field. Wondering if the wild plant she had run through had caused it. The thought of it didn't add much to the fact she had heard the voice summoning her to come inside the dark coop. Both Dick and Julia were still asleep as their daughter crept back upstairs to the bathroom located between the 2 bedrooms. There were a total of 5 bedrooms, 2 upstairs and 3 downstairs, but the 3 lower bedrooms weren't renovated or ready for moving into. The attic could have been a room, but Julia had already pursued it as hers for her paintings and philosophical artwork. Dick Feller planned on painting the bedroom downstairs as theirs and moving the baby upstairs beside Adeline's in due time. Adeline was in the bathroom where Julia had put the medical supplies when they arrived a morning before. She gripped the cabinet door, opening it to find a box of bandages and some Neosporin to place on her aching calves. She took them both out, placing them along the toilet seat, closing the mirror in front of her. Staring into it a moment, she noticed dust and grime had gotten on her face from outside. Cranking the aged knobs, they leveled the water until it was manageable to put her hands in. Using both her hands, she splashed water on her face and finished up using a cloth rag hanging on the sink side. Wrapping the bandage around one time, she tore it off and stuck the adhesive side against her leg to keep it tight. She continued with the second one, the same as her imagination swept her back to the box upstairs. The chest, I almost forgotten to check it. She murmured to herself as she left the bathroom, turning the light off. Arriving in her room, an uncanny feeling pummeled over her. The inexplicable rectangle-shaped box was gone. Examining the room, she peered underneath her bed and scrambled through the shipping boxes and found nothing. Then suddenly, she resorted back to the closet on the right of her room. As she gripped the door and pulled it open, her face lit up. "There you are, you had me worried. I really want to see what's inside of you," she said innocently as she grabbed a hold of it and slid it back out. There was a diamond-shaped hatch on the front, but she observed it to find it wasn't locked. Pushing the center and releasing the lid, it sprung upwards, throwing mold and dust back onto her face. Her hands were filthy again as well from bringing it out. "What is that you hold inside?" she asked in a sweet, quiet voice as she peered in further. Inside, lay a tan hand-stitched cloth covering something from being damaged. Her eyes heightened as she glared in at it before reaching for it. The smell of rotten lilacs radiated from the box as it sat ajar in front of her. Adeline was sitting on her knees along the wooden floor, holding on the side of the lid. "Let's get a look," she said, finally releasing her hold on it. She began putting her hands deep into the chest, wrapping them around something clothed. "You're in there tight ... and I'm going to get you out regardless of how stubborn you are," she said, almost whispering this time as she yanked it from the bottom. Lowering the clothed oddity and its remnants onto the floor, she rubbed her hands against her jeans, whipping the dust off. Something Julia had told her numerous times not to do. Adeline then continued to unfold the tan-stitched cloth away from it. Inside, as she pulled the final flap of cloth away, her eyes went weak as she held it. Tiny driblets of tearing ran down her face as she held the shattered, decaying bones of a newborn infant. The brittle skull of a baby and the rest of its fracturing bones were decrepit. It was crumbling off onto the floor beyond her as she held it, taking in the idea of it being murdered or put into the chest alive. Adeline May Feller placed the infant's remains back inside the cloth and peered once again into the large chest, sitting alone. Her eyes were soiled in dirty tears as she reached in again to pull a tarnished paper out from the bottom, two of them exactly. Raising them to her face, she could see it wasn't just a forgotten piece of oxidized paper left behind, it was a letter. A difficult letter, if that, whoever written it had been there when this all happened. She felt the closeness of the writer as she began to read it quietly in her mind. The letter was short but direct as she swept her eyes across it, imagining the devastation it must have caused. "Adeline," cried her father from outside of the room. He was still lying with Julian in the room across the way. "Are you awake yet, honey? It's almost time for your first day," he asked, clearing his voice afterwards and then coughing. Dick Feller had quit smoking after his father had passed 6 months earlier from throat cancer, although he still carried a nasty smoker's cough. "Yes, I'm awake. I'm just getting my room set up a bit," she said, hoping either of them would come in and discover the chest or what's inside it. "Meet me downstairs in 5," he cried from the other room. "Yes, okay, Dad," she replied, closing her door at the same time. It didn't have a lock on it, but she couldn't allow anyone to find what she had. Afraid they would pack up and move if they did. She lifted the remains back into the chest and fought herself to slide it back into the closet, setting all of her shoes back on top. Holding in the thought of the horse stable and the thought of a decaying body lying in her closet, it would weigh heavy on her 12-year-old mind and normality. Adeline rushed downstairs after washing a second time to hide the evidence of going out to the stable earlier. She had never lied before to either of her parents and hoped it wouldn't come up in case Julian or Dick asked. Since the first grade, she'd been an honor student and an avid student of the gospel at her previous church, even helping the Sunday school at times. "Ready for your first day, champ?" her father asked, sitting in the kitchen sipping a cup of Green Mountain coffee. It was his daily kickstart before work. Adeline stood not far from him at the table before sitting down. "First day for what, Dad?" "It's summer," she said, smiling at him as if nothing was bothering her. But, in reality, the thought of her discovery was eating her alive inside. Champ is what he nicknamed her since she was five. Her mother didn't exactly care for it, but it stuck with her even though it was masculine. "Your first day to investigate our new home sport," he said, almost chuckling as he sipped down another sip of hot coffee. She stood there not sitting down. Was this a game, she wondered to herself? Did he know something about her going out into the horse stable? Nah, he couldn't have, can he? She continued to wonder as he stared at her pouring the last bit of coffee into his stomach. "For sure, Dad, I've been ready since we arrived," she said, almost feeling inside as if she had just lied through her teeth. She almost wished it hadn't happened. The talk she had with him and the chest upstairs. "Where's your dolls, honey?" he asked her. It was unusual to see her without Dasha and Ruthie. She admired vintage dolls since she was just a little girl. The first time she had been to an antique store back in Darbsey with her parents Dick and Julia, she wanted her own collection the same as the one displayed there in the glass counter. "Well, I decided to take a break playing with them for now. It seems like there's so much more to do here," she said, half acting she cracked a witty smile at him. "That's good, darling. That really makes my day, champ," he said as he rose from the seat feet across from her, laying his cup inside the sink drain. Dick Feller pulled away in his boss's work van as dust sprinkled the air in the driveway. Julia was still asleep upstairs. She was a stay-home wife now that she had her space for painting. She had dreamed of taking her abstract art to another level since leaving her hometown. But, after getting married to Dick 12 years earlier, she had put the dream of pursuing it, on a much larger scale, on hold. Dick was the breadwinner and she was the homemaker now and the mother of two. A month ago, Dick Feller had a vasectomy after both agreed on two children. They had the world at their fingertips now, a new country home, Aid now striving in school and a new infant on the way. Nothing seemed impossible for the family. Back upstairs in her room, Adeline plopped down on her bed. Sprawled across the top of her covers, she was thinking hard about the eerie voice calling for her to come inside the collapsing horse stable turned chicken coop. It was now after 8 and the sun outside was now shining hard as ever in through the glass. Adeline poked her head up, lifting her body up until her cut legs were standing at the window front. Peering out from the window, she took a seat along the window sill against the wood. Two trees just outside the window towered almost to the glass as she stared out into the vast field of wild plants. The wind appeared subtle as earlier as she glared out towards the old pile of wood. Someone had once used as a horse stable. It was far in the distance as she watched. Thinking of the girl she had seen running aimlessly along the land as if she was playing by herself. And then the voice she had heard, it remained speaking to her as if it were in the room with her. But it wasn't, it was her nurse. "Aid," called out her mother Julian just outside her room. The door was open as she turned to see her mother standing there. "I'm going to help unpack your things later this afternoon, after I put away clothing. Do you want to help me?" she asked Adeline, standing now facing her from the opposite end of the room. "Yeah, I'll help you, Mom," she said. Julia was standing at the door holding a handful of metal hangers. "Oh, and Aid, I discovered an unusual cedar chest lying inside your closet space when I put your shoes away yesterday." Adeline's face suddenly went cold. The thought of the infant's corpse lying inside would devastate her mother. But, not only that, the current move from Darbsey and the fact she had miscarried just a month prior would surely wreck her. The hopeful mother she noticed the other night would be lost. Adeline didn't want to think about any of it, as she stared at her mother watching back at her. "Adeline, you seem quiet today. Is everything all right, honey? She asked, stepping into the room. Adeline was growing more nervous about the closet. She turned slightly, noticing the door had worked its way open an inch. Want me to show you the chest now? Asked Julia, standing by the doorway. Adeline's face suddenly brightened as she stepped closer to her mother, almost pushing her out of the room. No, that's all right, I'll see it when you come back to straighten my room with me. I really have to use the bathroom, she cried, holding her stomach. Julia had a concerned look on her face. Her eyes were wide and she was nervously biting her lip. I'll be right back, Mom, I'm feeling nauseous. Julia peered at her as she trudged past her in the entrance, making a quick getaway to the bathroom. Standing by the sink, she quietly murmured to herself, "Darn it, I shouldn't have done that. It wasn't right of me," she said, angrily clenching her fists at the edge of the sink. Suddenly, she could hear her mother's footsteps leading back down the noisy stairwell. Adeline ran the faucet a moment in hopes her mother wouldn't come back up anytime soon. The baffling chest was a huge problem now for her, and she had to get the deceased corpse out of the house before anyone noticed. Adeline May hastily tripped to her closet and opened it, noticing the cedar box was unmoved since earlier. Reaching inwards, she grasped the sides of it to pull it out, stopping halfway from the closet, knocking her shoes off during the process. Swiftly pushing the center release mechanism, the lid shot upwards before her standing over it. Without perceiving the foreboding contents, she gripped up the disintegrating remains crumbling within the rotten cloth. Heading rapidly for the stairs, she could overhear her mother down below in the cellar hammering something into. Adeline stared towards the kitchen just before arriving at the front doorway. The basement door was braced open against a pub stool. Julia Feller was hard at work down beneath the first floor, tacking a failing frame. At times she improvised using Dick's roofing nails, but they hardly held half the time. Her paintings were hefty and took a good spike to hold them down pat. Flying through the vastness of the sunlit field of wild violets and poppies blooming from the hardened soil, she glared towards the farthest point. Almost forgetting the eerie voice from earlier calling to her, her mind was lost in the moment. Clutching the tiny clothed remains of a lifeless infant, she barreled towards the broken-down coop. Approaching the horse stable-turned-chicken coop, Adeline slowed down and began treading towards it, holding the dead corpse. Her hands were holding it from underneath, pressing it against her upper chest as she made it past the clearing. The weeds were growing high as they brushed against her jeans. She fought the sun shining into her eyes as she approached the subsiding horse stable, now built of rotten wood. She stepped up to it, standing a foot from the opening. The same opening where she had spotted the dry straw scattered about inside. Peering in a moment, she waited for the same voice, but this time it didn't come. Staring in through the pitch-black opening, her eyes were wide and cautious of getting too close. Adeline suddenly lowered the bundle in her hands, placing it softly against the earth just before the stable. She leaned over it, silently fixing the cloth wrapped around the infant. Tightening the cloth covering it, she lifted it up again, this time crawling inwards towards the darkness with it. A second later, she found herself halfway inside, but it was too dark to see clearly. Her heart was racing in terror of the voice from earlier, but she could hear nothing as she sat inside with the baby's deteriorating remains. Staring from the side to side, she could sense someone watching her but couldn't see from where. Sitting the baby's remains along the scattered straw, she lowered herself to kiss him goodbye. Outside of the stable, she could now hear a distant thunder as she sat with him silently. She peered out into the field from inside, watching the weeds sway around her. It was a peaceful moment, one she'd never felt in her young life. It was almost harmonious being there with him alone in the dark. Suddenly she crawled back out and stood tall in the grass. Still staring at the opening, she was unable to see Jacob. She reached into her jeans where she had folded the letter. Realizing his name was Jacob, coincidentally, the very name her mother planned to name her previous son before miscarrying. She hadn't thought about his name until now. The letter shook in her hands as she repeated his name silently in her mind. Adeline wondered about his death and why it had happened. A mother's indestructible love for her newborn was now lost, taken from her, but why?
Adeline. Written by Jared Neely. Chapter 3, Jacob. To whom it may concern, January 23, 1889. My untimely death may be at the hands of my Maker. My father has grown wary of Travis and me. It worries me what he might be capable of if he discovers my pregnancy. In the near past he has threatened Travis and my unborn baby if I don't obey his wishes of waiting until marriage. I wish he'd die sometimes. He makes me feel trapped. Since mother's death I've been all he has. I don't understand why he's treating me as if I'm not his bloodline. It almost appears he's mistaken me as not his. Yesterday, I came downstairs to find father reading scripture from the Bible and he glared at me as if he knew I was pregnant. This horrifies me. He's been drinking his old crow. His hard liquor makes him even worse to be around. He's been aggressive with me. I can tell I'm impregnated with a boy. My stomach is showing now and even Travis agrees on us having a son. If I do fail to bring Jacob into the world, I hope someone finds this letter and helps bring our deaths into the light. I want the public to know who my father truly is. As a respected pastor in town, everyone sees him as a godly man, but he's the total opposite of what's good in this world. If I end up missing, know it was at my father's idle hands. I assure you if he finds out I'm doomed. Please. Never let my son die in vain. Remember my unborn child's whose name will be Jacob Taylor Edmonton. He's the last sole survivor of our family tree. His death needs to mean something, better to come. Sincerely, Luella Edmonton. Adeline Mayfeller folded the letter, hurrying to get back to her parents' house acres behind her. The commencing thunder she heard a moment earlier had somehow stopped and proceeded towards the hills miles out. Adeline peered up at the sky, noticing the blueness covering over her. The clouds were bright and the sun was intense as it gleamed down at her. Even the collapsing horse stable appeared to dazzle under the fierce rays. She quickly turned back towards the colonial in the distance and began a sluggish walk back. Her thoughts were on Jacob and the letter, but something more seemed to draw her in. In the back of her thoughts, the colonial appeared to hold a dark secret, Luella's father. What had happened to him, if both Luella and Jacob were slaughtered by the hands of a religious father gone too far? The question was baring its wicked teeth as it chewed inside her 12-year-old mind. Opening the front door, she hastily made her way upstairs to push the cedar box back into the closet. She had left it ajar and in open view of her mother. As she reached the flight of stairs leading upwards to her room, she suddenly heard sobbing coming from below within the cellar. The sniveling noise was resonating from the kitchen, where the cellar doors appeared to be open. Plodding in that direction, she followed the faint cry. Adeline gripped the door as she poked her face in to see as she flipped the light switch. But, nothing happened. It was pitch black inside. "Hello? Mom, is that you?" she cried down into the depths of darkness covering the musty cellar. The whimpering sound was even fainter as she lowered her feet onto the first step. Peering downwards, the noise was growing closer to her as she cautiously dawdled to the surface below. Adeline's face suddenly went cold, chilled like ice. Julia was lying face down with her hands stretched above her. It was too dark in the shady space to see her injuries, as Adeline reached a foot ahead, kneeling down beside her to comfort her. "Gosh, Mom, I'm going to call an ambulance," she cried, as her mother wept, attempting to pull herself up from the cemented floor away. "No, honey, I'm not broken, I don't think, anyways, just in pain." "I'm not bleeding, am I?" she asked her daughter, standing now beside her worried. Julia spoke faintly as she breathed in. It appeared she had badly bruised herself. "You seem to be bleeding from your forehead, it's too dark to see," Adeline answered back. Julia struggled to lift her body from the aged floor. "If your father seen me like this, he would be losing it," she then added, noticing Adeline beside her. "Why is your hair and face covered in pollen? Were you outside, honey?" she asked her, trying hard to hide her increasing pain. She stood by her, peering down. "I went to the horse stable, I'm sorry," she said. Guilt had finally taken over her. Julia laid there, reaching for her chest as she gripped the ground with her other hand. Before she rose to her feet, She stopped and angled her eyes on Adeline. It's all right, I'll keep it between us this time. Next time your father will hear about it, understand? She said, her expression was of pain as she fought her wounded body to get up. Adeline peered at her as she balanced along the surface, holding onto the railing along the steps leading out. She didn't say anything to Julia as she wrenched her arm around her in an attempt to walk her back up to the kitchen. Mom, I'm worried about your belly. Is the baby going to be all right? Adeline asked her, as the two slowly crept up to the kitchen. I really hope so, darling. I don't think I hit it. Babies can be resilient, she finished as the two made it to the top. Dick Feller and Julia were lying in bed that night. Adeline was asleep in her room. It was midnight and the two were both lying together reading. Julia had taken Darvana prescription painkillers she had been giving after a nearly breaking her ankle a summer ago. She had tripped stepping out from the tub when it happened. The Darvon was finally beginning to kick in. The pain was decreasing as she read a novel she had borrowed a week earlier at the Portsmouth Library in town. Julia Feller was lying on her side away from Dick as he read his popular science magazine. Her head was lacerated, but it wasn't bleeding any longer. A bandage covered her wound as she read quietly, quickly noticing the lampshade at her side flickering. She was wearing a short-sleeved nightshirt and a pair of gray sweatpants, as she leaned forward to fix the bulb on the end table beside their bed. The bulb had flickered twice and appeared to be dying out. Suddenly Dick turned, peering at her as she leaned off from the bed. Holy shit, babe, what the hell are those? He asked, sounding exceedingly surprised beside her. Julia turned facing him as astonished as him. What? What's wrong, hon? She replied, feeling behind her, reaching with her hand to feel her back. I can't feel anything. She cried, staring Dick in the face. Honey, you have three deep nasty scrapes on your lower back. He said, as he touched her in the scored area. Oh my God, you know what, when I first fell down the cellar stairs this afternoon I could have sworn I was pushed. She said, appearing bewildered as she stared at Dick at her side. Well, tomorrow we'll have a look at the stairs and make sure there's nothing exposed that you may have tripped on, he said, picking up his magazine again. Julia twisted back into her previous position along the bed, pulling the cover up on both of them. That sounds like a good idea. We don't want Adeline falling down there, she replied, as she picked her book back up and opened it to the middle. It was just past one in the middle of the night and Adeline twisted restlessly in her bed. Her eyes were pasted shut as she kicked her covers down. She was in the field running breathlessly, catching butterflies in a long-handled net. Julia was on the front step way peering at her in the distance, and Dick was jiggling spark plug wires around underneath the hood of his 1969 Corvair. It was summertime and the sun was bright above the field while Adeline ran through the acres of wild fern. Her dark brown hair blew in the subtle air behind her as she scooped her net at the butterflies. They were fluttering from the poppies below her in the dry grass as she speedily caught a rare Taeno palpus aureus. The butterfly was a beautiful dark green and black. A moment after snatching it from the air, it paused its rapidly fluttering wings, watching her from within the net. I won't hurt you, little guy, she cried, opening the netted side to free it into the air. The colorful butterfly flung into the sky higher than before with its antennas stretched in front of it as Adeline watched calmly below. Suddenly, as she stood in the far distance from the aging colonial, a burst of cold chilling air caught her ear. The inhospitable exhalation of breath freakishly turned into a long howling voice as it carried into her innocent dream. It howled, reverberating into the open sky around her. Come to me, Aide. Suddenly, the cold breath turned increasingly hot as it burned her ear. Her eyes opened that very second as she peered around her room, still lying on the bed. The voice came to slow ringing as she rubbed her eyes, tired and half alert. A moment later she closed her eyes again, resting against the pillowcase, and dropped into a heavy slumber. Midway through the night, Adeline woke to the sound of scratching on the ceiling above her canopy bed. The top of it had been removed since they arrived in Franklin Town. Her father had unscrewed it to get it through the archway in her room. He didn't get a chance to reassemble it with work and the heavy rush of Julia being pregnant. The scratching sound was slightly dragging from one end of the room to the other, above her as she stared up at it. It sounded as if something was peeling away at the insulation within the wood a few feet above her underneath her covers. Adeline listened to it as she gawked at the ceiling in the darkness. Outside, the windows had turned black in the shade of night, even the moon seemed dim. It sounded like razor-edged fingernails prodding against wood and insulation paper. Adeline's eyes were fixated above her, concentrating on the strange noise. The house was quiet around her, other than the disturbing scraping conflicting above her, keeping her from her rest. She glared at the dresser her mother had brought up that afternoon while she was out. She had even moved the cedar chest back into the closet with her shoes. Julia hadn't said a word about it. Adeline wasn't even certain she had checked inside it. It didn't matter all that much. Jacob was in a safe place and couldn't upset her any longer. The dresser was on the right-hand side of her room and had her two favorite dolls abroad it. Disha and Ruthie were facing her bed as she glared at them. "Do you hear that noise?" she whispered towards them with the covers pulled halfway up to her face. "I'm terrified of it, but I know, God, and you two will keep me safe," she said, still listening with her eyes on her dolls. Suddenly, the sinister scratching sound groaned distinctively louder as it dug deeply into the wood atop the ceiling. It began revolving angrily and ferociously above. She watched in the dark, abruptly becoming nervous of the hair-raising noise. Then, without warning, the ceiling above her began to crack within. She heard it as she jumped from the bed, quickly treading towards the bedroom doorway. Standing there with the door shut, she flipped the switch for the ceiling lamp, but it was burnt out. She was unable to see the door handle as she felt aimlessly for it, finally gripping it. Opening the heavy door, the sound instantaneously came to a progressing stop. "Mom, Dad? Wake up, can you hear that?" she shrieked in panic of the anomaly above her room. At first they seemed to be in a dead sleep across from her room on the same hall. "Mom!" she cried loudly towards their room. Suddenly, their door popped open and Julian came hurrying out into the hallway. "Adeline? What's wrong, honey?" she asked, concerned, wearing a robe over her. Adeline stared at her and pointed towards the door of her bedroom. It had shut on its own somehow. "That wasn't shut a moment ago," she cried at her mother, now plodding towards the door, unnerved by her daughter's behavior. The door was jammed as she pushed against it. "What did you do?" she asked, with a puzzled look upon her face. "I didn't do anything. Isn't it opening?" Adeline asked her, noticing her mother struggling to get inside. "It's locked or stuck fast, I don't know. Let me wake your father," she said as she strolled back to her room. A moment later, Dick and Julia both approached Adeline a foot from the door. "What exactly is the problem, damn it? I have work early, aid," he said frustratingly, exhausted from the long shift he'd finished at the plant. "It's not aid's fault, Dick," her mother said, defending her as he pushed his weighty body against the old wooden door. It didn't budge. "This is just great, fucking great," he shouted aloud as he released his grip on the handle. "I'll get this son of a bitch open, I'll be right back. I'm gonna get my screwdriver downstairs," he said, biting his lip, trying hard not to go overboard. He cussed like a sailor at times. Julia had warned him before about it. Adeline was above her age group but didn't particularly like it when he lost his cool. "Your father's going to be moody tomorrow, Aide. I think we will have to stay out of his way," she said. Adeline peered at her and then nodded, agreeing with her. It had taken him no longer than a minute and he was back with them. Indignant, he began stabbing the tip of the screwdriver into the door. "This piece of shit coming off as soon as I get money for a new one, and some fresh hinges are gonna be slapped on as well," he shouted. Julia left the two there, hastily heading back into her room. "Wonder what crawled up her ass?" he asked, still fighting with the rusted bolts holding the heavy door. Adeline remained there watching, quietly at his side. "I'm sorry, baby, Daddy's just tired from work," he said, giving her a light pat against her head, sitting there with him along the hall. "There, I got it, honey, The door fell to the floor as he pulled the pins holding it. Dick Feller clutched the hefty door in his arms, carrying it towards the bathroom. He sat it against the wall between the three. "Good as new, darling," he said. Adeline didn't feel the same. "Good as new?" She wondered about that a moment. "What about that noise, Dad?" she asked him, as he tucked the screwdriver down into the sweat line of his night pants. "Noise? What noise do you mean?" he asked her, squinting his face confused. "The ceiling in my room, I heard a horrifying scratching sound. It woke me up," she cried. Her face was blush as she faced him. "Honey, you're overreacting. It's probably just a squirrel or a possum getting into the wiring. They tend to do that when searching for food," he said. "Now get back to bed, Aide." Adeline crept back into her room and slid underneath the covers. Peering at the open doorway, it made her feel somewhat better. She attempted closing her eyes, but she couldn't get back to sleep. Deciding to get up again, she stepped over to her dolls and plucked them both off. Holding Disha and Ruthie against her, she crept towards the window to her left. Sitting down along the window sill, she stared out into the dark night. She was incapable of seeing anything, just her own reflection in the glass. She lowered her head, kissing Ruthie along her hair, raising her eyes back onto the window ahead of her. Immediately, something in the glare of her own presence squeezed her by the throat, stealing all the air from her deflating lungs. The blood-curdling specter behind her was eyeballing her as if it could see inside her very soul. Adeline fought to breath but was enfeebling, slumping over, peering in shock at the gruesome apparition beholding her in its gazing eyes. Its appalling glare had siphoned the color from her face, leaving it a bright pale shade of bluish-white. Her eyes were fixated. Staring at herself, but just beside her in the same room was the disfigured complexion of another woman. Her unnatural presence wrenched into her, sitting lifelessly staring in silence. Adeline's heart nearly skyrocketed from her shaken chest. Every hair upon her body was standing still and she was unable to breathe. "Mo!" She fought to scream, dropping the dolls as they rolled across the floor at her feet. The horrifyingly repugnant face of a deceased hag was hovering at her shoulder and she was unable to move from the seat. Paralyzed, watching the face in her own image against the glass, it suddenly vanished in the nightshade. Adeline sat there, finally able to breathe in oxygen, silently shaking. Her arms and legs were quivering in extreme fear, but she couldn't wake her father again, he'd lose it. Chapter 4, Spade of Death. The next morning arrived as the sun bared its vibrant rays in through the window, hitting Adeline directly in the face, waking her. She began pulling on the same jeans and open-toed shoes lying at the foot of her bed. Already wearing a nightshirt, she began hastily trudging towards her parents' bedroom on the same hall. Adeline reached her parents' door. It was shut as she knocked. "Mom? Dad, are you awake yet?" she asked from the opposite end of the door, anxiously waiting to tell them about the horrible face watching her. She stood patiently waiting for one of them to get out of bed. Suddenly, Julia came out into the hall, combing her lengthy blonde hair. "Yes, honey?" she asked her as she passed by her, heading towards the middle-sized bathroom between both rooms. Adeline followed her, and stopped beside the door, peering in at her mother as she clutched a toothbrush from the holder. "There's something wrong here, Mom. I don't want to live here any longer. My room's haunted." Julia stopped brushing a moment. Her eyes were on her daughter. "Honey, there's nothing here, nothing that can hurt you." Julia paused a moment as she turned back to the mirror hanging just above the sink. "You're not listening to me, Mom," Adeline said, with eagerness in her voice. "I seen a dead woman last night. She wasn't alive, Mom. Her face was horrible. There's no way in hell I'm sleeping in that room again." She raised her voice towards her mother in hopes she'd understand. But Julia didn't appear to be interested in her story. She had always been skeptical of the afterlife. "Listen, Adeline, we need to make this move work. Your father has been thrown under a lot of duress at work. He needs our support, and the last thing he wants to hear is the house is haunted," Julia said, continuing as she rinsed the brush, putting it back. Adeline shook her head in disappointment. walking away as she strolled down the stairwell to the first floor of the mysterious colonial. Adeline, called Julia from atop the stairs just as she made it out the front door, closing it behind her. She stopped along the porch outlooking the pasture. The weather was humid this morning and the sky was alluring over top the colonial. Such a beautiful property, she thought as she peered out across the serene farmland. Luella, what happened to you and your baby? She said aloud, standing along the top of the stone stairway. Was it you last night watching me? She asked, quietly as she stepped onto the steps leading down into the vast field. Dick Scorvor was missing from the driveway. He had left early to fill in for a sick employee down in Portsmouth at the Fuller's Brothers Company. Adeline circled over towards the gravel where his car mainly parked, noticing a bent cigarette butt lying in the dirt. He's smoking again, she thought to herself. He knew exactly what that meant. It meant he was falling off the wagon. Dick Feller was once an abusive alcoholic, but that was when she was younger. She had overheard the story one day, while Julia was on the phone with her grandmother. Dad, please don't do this, she thought to herself, speaking in her thoughts, as she picked up the half-burnt butt and stuck it in her pocket. She didn't want Julia to know, her being pregnant was enough to deal with. Adeline began weaving through the field leading to the stable, where she had placed Jacob's decomposing body. Midway through the pasture, her shoe hit something bluntly sticking out from the dry soil. She stood in the tall grass and wildflowers sprouting wildly from the dirt. Ouch! Holding her foot, she was sliced along her toe, as she glared at the object underneath her. What in the? She stared at it for a moment, trying to determine what it was. The piece of wood appeared to be the handle of a D-handle-shaped coal shovel from the early 1800s. Whatever you are, you're old, I can tell that for sure, she murmured. Standing along the wild poppies and yellow flowers, she peered towards the stable a few yards out from her. She quickly debated within her thoughts if approaching the stable was a rational idea with her mother aware of her being outdoors. Going for it, she hurried in its direction. As she reached the rundown coop, she peered inwards through the opening leading inside where Jacob lay. Jacob, it's me, Adeline, I'm back to see you, she whispered under her breath, peering from side to side, making sure nobody had seen her getting there. She ducked down, as she kneeled along the straw leading inside the dark enclosure. Crawling in it was pitch black, as she felt around blindly for Jacob. Her hands were grabbing for him in the dark where she had sat him a day earlier. Brushing her hands through the scattered hay and dry straw, she began to panic. Jacob wasn't anywhere inside. Jacob, she said, feeling the ground below in the blackness. Jacob, you're worrying me, where are you? She spoke, worrying about his remains being taken away from her. Tears began to stream again from her face, realizing his clothed corpse was missing. She knew the reality of it, and that he might never be seen again if a wild animal had anything to do with it. Afterwards, she crawled back out into the sunlight, standing up along the collapsing building. Circling the coop with her eyes down at the ground, she felt a sharpness growing inside her stomach. Her eyes were pinpointed along the overgrown shrubs and wildflowers on the ground. Leading further out into the woods, terror took hold of her. Jacob's deteriorating carcass was scattered randomly along the high grass leading deep into the woodland. Her body suddenly went limp, as she picked each bone from the earth below her. I'm sorry, Jacob, she said, sobbing to herself, isolated not far from the horse stable behind her. Gathering the bones, she hurried to put them inside the stable, tossing them along the straw. Worried of her mother, Julia would soon wonder where she was. A few yards away from the old den, she retrieved the moth-eaten cloth, once used to clothe Jacob, inside the cedar chest. Putting it inside the dark confinement, she quickly blew a kiss towards Jacob and treaded desperately back to the house. Heading upstairs, her mother was in her room as she reached the upper floor. Hey! She said, surprised by her. Aide, is there anything you want to tell me? Her mother asked her, sounding concerned. Her face was blush and her eyes appeared watered. What do you mean, Mom? Is everything all right? She said, hoping she hadn't noticed her down by the stable. You know exactly what I mean, Julia said, pulling the neatly folded letter out in her hand. What is this aid? She questioned her, opening it as if it were the first time. I was meaning to tell you I found it, Adeline quickly added, standing in the doorway watching her mother. Have you read this? Her mother asked, skimming through the dreadful letter and then quickly folding it back into place. I know where you were aid, Julia said, shaking her head in frustration. Why are you playing with this stuff? Her mother asked, handing her the letter as if it were hers originally. But it wasn't, it was Luella's. This is what I've been talking about, Mom, something's off. About this place, she said, holding the letter before shoving it in her back pocket. It must have fallen out when she put her jeans on earlier. I'm done with this subject, Aid, I told you. Your father has been head over hot water with work lately, she said, taking an empty moving box with her as she wandered out from her room. Suddenly, just outside of the doorway, Julia fell over, catching herself along the banister. Adeline, call your father. My water broke, honey. Hurry, I think the baby's coming. Julia shouted, in pain as she held the wooden arm of the old banister holding on until she could get back. Adeline hurried downstairs to use the phone. It was hooked up along the kitchen wall a day earlier, but she hadn't seen either her mother or father use it since. As she clutched the receiver from the hook, she dialed his work number. It was written on a piece of painter's tape along a calendar her mother hung beside the phone. It rang and rang, until finally Dick's boss answered. Hey Adeline, is everything going well with your mom? He asked, before she could tell him her water had burst along floor upstairs. I'm sorry to cut you off like this, but I need my father. Mom's having the baby, I think she is. Anyways, she cried into the phone. He didn't say any more, as Dick Feller grabbed the phone. Baby, is something wrong? I'm leaving work now, tell your mom, honey, I'll be there in 20 minutes. He said as the line split. Julia was resting against the old lacquered banister that held an odd shine in the musty hallway upstairs. Crouching against the floor, the wood underneath her was wet with amniotic fluid. She was already contracting and in labor as she awaited Dick to arrive from Fuller's Brothers with the 16-9 Corvore. Suddenly, Adeline came flying up the stairwell to find her mother breathing heavily, counting to herself quietly. An unusual burning sensation filled her stomach as she leaned heavily against Adeline, attempting to get downstairs to the front doorway until Dick would get there. Baby, hold my arm as tight as you can, I'm losing my balance, Julia cried, sounding short of breath, clutching her arm across her rounded belly. I will, Mom, I have a hold of you, I won't allow you to fall again, she said, concerned for her mother and unborn sibling, with the thought of Jacob running across her mind. As the two held hands, they arrived at the large door. Julia was leaning forwards with both arms across her baby. Okay, honey, open the door for your father, that way we're ready to leave when he pulls in, she said. Her face was paler now, appearing weak as she gripped the door. Adeline quickly pulled it open. Her mother's hands were shaking rapidly in front of her. Moments later, the two watched from the stone stairs as Dick rambled up the driveway just off Sam Damis Road. His Corvore rattled as it hit the stony driveway, pulling it within feet of the sandstone wall leading up to the colonial. Dick Feller opened the driver's side door, running to the opposite side for Julia to slide in. Dick was wearing a blue button-down work shirt with his first name embroidered across the front pocket. On the back of him, read the company's name, Fuller's Brothers Company. He appeared overworked, his face was a dark shade of red as he approached them both. Taking Julia, Adeline followed behind, hurrying to the idling car. We're going to the Community General in Portsmouth, he said, as Adeline closed her door, sitting behind Julia. It's the nearest hospital I know of, he added, before either of them could say anything. Grasping the steering wheel, he dropped the gear into reverse along the steering column, backing out of the driveway. The Fellers sat patiently for an update of Julia, but it seemed to be a long while. A pediatric nurse named Franny had taken her back just as they arrived. Dick was still in the process of signing her in as the nurse came wheeling a wheelchair in for her to sit. Dad? Asked Adeline, staring at the man across from her in the waiting area. Yes, champ? He replied, with his eyes peering towards the clock hanging above the main entrance. Is the baby going to be all right? She asked him, now staring him in the face. Before he said anything, she took notice of his aging complexion. His face was stubbly with a 5 o'clock shadow, and his goatee was whitening. His hair was black and cut shorter than in his younger days. Adeline had never realized it, as she observed him. Dick Feller was nearly 39 and had already succeeded his own father, who died of liver disease many years back. Yes, darling, he said, putting his hands together with his head down. I found this. She said, noticing him lifting his tired eyes. Pulling the spent cigarette butt from her pocket, his face became suddenly wide awake. Where you find that? He asked her, picking it out from her hand. He appeared embarrassed as he twisted it underneath his face along his lap. I found it laying in our drive. She said, smirking at him. The nurse they ran into coming in known as Franny approached them holding a clipboard and pen. Her white nurse's gown was drowning her skinny mid-aged body. Her hair was a golden red and it lay along her back and shoulders. Excuse me, you're the Fellers, correct? She asked them, pointing the pen at Dick as he sat impatiently. Well, I have some unfortunate news for you and your family, she said, noticing his eyes growing wide as he sat deeply towards the back of the plastic seat. What are you getting at? He asked, growing in wonder as he lifted himself onto his feet. Sir, your wife is having some very critical complications, she said, as she took him into the office in the far corner of the waiting area. Is it okay if I speak to you confidentially? Please, Mr. Feller. I'd rather your daughter learn these things from you, she said. Adeline grew worried as she sat along the row of empty seats, watching them close the door to the office. A small television hung from the wall as it flashed above her. She thought about the stable, and then about Jacob, and how she had found his scattered body strewn across the property of the mysterious colonial. Then she began to worry about her mother, and then of her father, and what they were talking about in the tightly cornered office. She re-raced the nurse's face, remembering how serious she had appeared a moment before. Something wasn't right, Julia, or the baby was in danger. Her gut gave her the intuition as she sat awaiting her father to come out. What expression he'd have on his face would tell her everything. A moment had passed, finally the door opened as her father approached her. Franny walked away as she left into the hallway where a patient was lying on a wheel table. He was covered with white linen and he had a hair bonnet on his head. Adeline watched as she arrived at his side. Nurse, am I going to be discharged anytime soon? He shouted as he grabbed hold of her arm. Adeline quickly turned facing her father, leaving the two talking. Dad, is Mom all right? Is the baby going to be all right? She cried, as he sat down reaching for her hand. His face was desolate and his eyes were tightened as he lifted his eyes on her sitting there. Sweetie, I have some really, really terrible information about your mom, he said, staring at her. She awaited his response as her stomach knotted. The baby was born stillbirth, he didn't make it during delivery. I'm extremely overwrought about your mother. She isn't speaking, she will be staying here at least a week in recovery, he said, as Adeline stared in a total loss of words. Stillbirth? She thought as her heart shattered into a million pieces sitting there in the waiting room. Why? How could this happen to her again? She wondered inside, almost forgetting about her father beside her in pain. It appears I'll be leaving you at home with your mother's friend, Dina. You remember her, don't you? She attended the same institution as your mother. Yes, I remember her. The windmill painting Mom has downstairs was painted by her, right? She asked, feeling horribly, but wanted her father to cheer up if that was even possible. His eyes were dim as he peered at her. Yes, darling. The 69 Corvair spit rocks out behind it as it sped into the drive leading towards the colonial. Adeline was in the passenger seat as Dick pulled it up into the stony drive, coming to a sudden stop at the steps. Another car was beside his as they got out, a dented station wagon. Adeline never seen it before, but she knew Dina was already inside waiting because she heard her father on the hospital phone that he had left a set of spare keys for her to go inside. He kept them under a plant vase on the deck. "Adeline, Dina's going to be here for a few days to keep an eye on you. I'm going to be with your mother until she's well enough to come back home," he said as they walked together up the sturdy well of stairs leading to the door. "Tell Mom I love her and I will be here thinking about her, and tell her I'm sorry about the pregnancy," she said, fighting the tears building up around her eyes. Dick Feller also had tears formed around his tired eyes. "I will, baby. She will be all right, give her a little time," he said, almost sounding not as himself. That night the sky was much thicker than usual and it smelled different as well. The rotten smell of lilacs surfaced in Adeline's room as she laid in the darkness. She could smell it as she breathed in. It was strange to her as she took notice of the flowery scent. "I hate that horrible smell," she thought as she laid thinking about Julia. Hoping her mother would be able to move forward after losing a second child in such a short time. Dina Ethers was downstairs sleeping on the couch Dick had made up for her on a short notice. It was late as Adeline lay in her room fighting herself to get comfortable, but the death of her baby sibling was just too hard to contemplate. Lying there she began to think of the stable again, wondering if Jacob had been born alive or if Luella also had some sort of complication. She wrestled with the thought. The nightshade was causing a weird shadow to flicker in through the windows across from her bed. She peered from her covers laying there wondering what was causing them. Disha and Ruthie were at her side, both lying there keeping her company along her pillow in the pitch black. She unhurriedly sat up along the edge of the bed and roamed to the windows on the back side of the room. Suddenly, as she peered out into night, she caught a sudden glimpse of the girl she had seen earlier. Staring, she noticed the girl approaching the stone stairs leading up to the house. Adeline's eyes were wide as she watched in curiosity of her. The moment she reached the middle of the ancient stairs, she unsuspectingly peered directly up at Adeline. Adeline shrieked in horror, catching herself from disturbing Dina. She held her face in terror, noticing the girl's clothing and how horrible her face had become as she eyed her from below the outside wall. The window in front of her was like ice as she touched it, almost breathing against it now, watching the woman. Adeline's eyes glued on her a moment. Something caught her eyes yet again, turning away, peering further out. Unsuspectingly, her eyes caught an elderly man standing in the faraway distance. He wore a pair of dark bibs, the color of them shielded in the night. A straw top hat covered him as well as he began striking vigorously into the ground. He was down below her clutching a rustic coal shovel in his hands. It was apparent to Adeline, who now was gawking heartily at him, that the man was blindly at work in the midst of digging some sort of trench. He dug desperately as he struck fast towards the gaping ground. Suddenly, Adeline dropped her eyes back onto the girl below, but she had vanished. Adeline's eyes tightened as she scanned the field from above. Suddenly, she met her treading towards the older man. Her dark hair was long and streaming behind her. A white and black floral pattern dress dragged along behind her as well, sweeping through the wild poppies and wild flowers leading out towards the strange unknown figure. Just as she reached him, his shovel fell from his hands along the dirt. Unsuspectingly, both spun around instantaneously facing Adeline above, watching back. Terror surfaced inside her as she leaned backwards, hoping that she hadn't been caught staring. The image of them both gawking at her rang warning bells across her maturing mind. Warning bells unlike any uneasy feeling she'd ever felt. She could sense her fingertips go cold as if someone was pinching against them. As she crouched against the wooden floorway, she observed her room once again, making certain nobody was watching. Adeline remained low, tiptoeing back to the porch just before the double windows. A strange, eerie feeling of fear burrowed over her as she peered outwards. Now inches from the stained glass, she bravely poked her eyes back into her withered complexion, suddenly realizing they both had vanished. They were nowhere to be seen as she glanced from the side, hiding half of her face in the curtains. Gluing her eyes into the heavy darkness, she watched for them to return, but nothing appeared out of the ordinary. Back on top of her bed, she laid in a complete silence. She pictured Jacob lying in the horse stable, picked apart like she had found him. Then, Julia, the thought of her losing another fetus was damning her as she lay unable to relax. Her eyes shut as she wished it would all go away, and shed awake as if it had been a pointless dream. A moment had passed as she tried, but nothing. She felt compelled lying there on top of her covers. Ruthie and Disha were now stacked against the bedside. In a sitting position, almost as if they were her guardians in some adolescent way they really were, the more she pondered to herself. Lying down, her body was awake more than earlier. It was almost uncanny lying there wide awake. The image of the two washed up in her thoughts, filling her with a multitude of questions. Questions of who they were, and why they had come. Part of her knew something unearthly had been beckoned there. She wondered if it were Jacob's remains, and how she had tampered with it, not knowing much else. Adeline turned to face the bedroom doorway where Dick had unscrewed the door a night before. Her eyes traced the tiny core of light the downstairs cast along the framework, but she couldn't see any further. The hallway outside was pitch black and dead silent. The next morning, Adeline awoke heading downstairs to greet her babysitter, but found her in a hard sleep. She was on her side facing the kitchen entrance with her arms folded against herself. Adeline wondered about her parents staring at her lying comfortably against the old couch. She thought of her parents, knowing they both couldn't possibly be as fortunate. She was sure both Dick and Julia had one of the roughest nights since getting married. Another death only meant one thing. Another funeral to attend. The thought overwhelmed her standing before her mother's friend. She slept soundless as Adeline left her there, entering into the kitchen. She hadn't spent much time in there since her mother's fall a couple days earlier. Thinking of it now reminded her of Jacob. The faded shorts she had slipped on showed the unusual scratches along the back of her legs. Her eyes clenched as she ran her fingers against the scabs forming. Adeline stood by the doorway attached to the living room. She turned facing her mother's friend again, unsuspectingly staring towards the wall. She noticed two family picture frames had been turned upside. Her family portrait had somehow swung and stayed the way it was. It gave her sudden chills as she approached them. Her feet were bare as she crept towards the wall where Julia had tacked them. Adeline. Written by Jared Neely. Treading over along the aging carpet, she abruptly stopped in her tracks. Strangely, tracks would be the right reference. There was tiny shoe impressions molded along the beaten rug. They were fresh and appeared not to be made not long ago. The mud tracks led partway to the wall where they came to a dead stop and didn't show any signs of turning back. Adeline quickly crouched along the floor to touch them. As she knelt towards the mysterious shoe stamps, her stomach suddenly began to hurt. An odd heaviness around her made it hard for her to breathe as she stood again. Clutching her lower stomach, she began to feel a dizziness overtake her. Unable to talk or cry for help, she could sense the life being drawn out from her body. Desperately attempting to wake her mother's friend, she collapsed onto the floor just a foot from the funny frames. Dick Feller pulled the Corvette into the driveway in desperation as stood awaiting him upon the porch. She was holding her chest as she neared him getting out of the driver's door. The colonial gleamed, basking in the summer sunshine behind the two as Dick's emotionless face stopped inches in front of her. "Where is Adeline?" he demanded towards her. Her hands left her chest and were now on her mouth. She appeared baffled, standing along the stony drive. "That's why I called you, Dick." She speedily spoke at him, a nervous look in her eyes. He stared at her a moment. "Did you check the property?" he asked, turning in all directions. He scanned the vast field in hopes of spotting her playing. "Julian's a complete wreck right now. Couldn't you keep a simple eye on her?" he shouted and slammed the driver's door forcefully. Her eyes were locked on the field as he walked past her. Something inside of him wanted to knock her teeth out as he trudged into the wildflowers and uncut grass growing knee-high already. "Dick, I'll check the house one more time while you're out here," she said as she bolted back inside. Dick remained quiet in frustration as he stomped into the field ahead leading out towards the horse stable. The sky was a bright orange like red in color above him. There wasn't any sign of rain and the clouds cropped around the sky magnificently. Almost like white cotton swirled up into a massive foray. Dick took notice of its soft appearance as he neared the collapsing foundation ahead of him. Suddenly he tripped landing along the heavily weeded ground, a stick had somehow caught his boot. As he rose back onto his feet he realized it wasn't particularly a stick at all. It was the fractured handle of a broken shovel. Beside it was fresh ground piled along the top of the surface. It appeared to him that somebody had been digging on the colonial's property. He left it laying there a moment, again approaching the wreckage left behind. Arriving at the stable he crouched down into the entrance and peered into the darkness of the tightly confined space. Boards hung down in all directions battered with bent nails and chicken wire. It ran across his mind there was enough rust for a few weeks of tetanus shots if you ended up getting pricked. "Adeline," he whispered, not quite knowing why he was but he did. He could feel eyes burning on him through the pitch black. "Are you in here?" he asked again. And again using his voice softly. He sensed something wasn't exactly right about the structure. Something felt strange, almost a spawning evil radiated from it. "Come out, Aide, if you in here I'm not mad at you," he said, hoping she heard him if she was. Adeline didn't answer back. Dick had his head partially in the opening where she had crawled in earlier but fought to see much of anything. He suddenly reached for his pocket. Still crouched in the only light available which came from the outside. He struck the lighter until a flame opened inside where even still the darkness of it shielded him. With his boots against the ground he balanced himself using his knees and reached in to feel around. Lowering the torch his eyes began to water from the butane rising into him. He closed them a moment to clear them, suddenly he could see a moth-eating cloth lying a foot from the opening. Dick gripped it almost snagging it along one of the nails hanging along the dirty straw inside. Pulling it out into the sunlight bones crumbled and snapped as they rolled out from the partially wrapped cloth. He was at a loss of words as he examined them standing in the heat. Both of his hands were shaking as he thought of his daughter. Turning back towards the colonial his eyes fought to see her room towering above the property. It was too far to see clearly. But the windows of her room glistened in the distance. The colonial seemed alive that very moment as he gawked at its beauty. For the first time since moving in he could sense its tragic past through all of its stunning lies. He stared at it and then turned back towards Jacob's remains lying in a dusty heap. As he walked back towards the colonial his eyes hadn't left the ground, the thought of Aide and Julia culminated his every thought and worry. The heat from above was now burning into the shoulders of his work clothes. He hadn't had time to change since Julia collapsing and him leaving work. He pinched the name stitched into his shirt almost in a rage of frustration. He almost felt sorry for himself again. For having contemplations on drinking and starting back on the cigarettes. Dick knew that moment he had jeopardized his family again by doing so. This would make it twice and who knew if he would be fortunate enough to get a third chance. "I'm a fucking screw up," he thought as he plodded through the summer heat making ground towards the driveway. Suddenly he lifted his eyes surprised, surprised not only of himself and his cowardly actions but by his wife's so-called best friend. She had left and her car was gone. Her raggedy station wagon had somehow managed to escape another one of his rampant rampages. Exhausted and worn down from hospital visits and searching for aid he wasn't even sure he had another one in him. A rampage that is, all he could do now is continue to search and by nightfall he did before calling the police. Putting out a missing persons report he dropped the phone down onto the receiver and put his head down onto the kitchen table. Awaiting his wife to call or for the police to hear anything. He hadn't said anything to Julia about Adeline, She was broke and the hospital had put her on watch just in case her depression plunged deeper. Dick's fingers were a dark red as he stretched out his arms in front of him laying there. His face against the cold tabletop felt nice. It was about the most comforting feeling he had all day, maybe two. Outside, the humidity had risen greatly, causing the colonial to feel less inviting for him. His hands were blood red from work and stress. His father's were the same as a kid. It was oddly hereditary. Midnight came without any sign of hope as he rose up from the table to pour a glass of milk from the fridge. Peering out from a small window above the sink drain, he watched for Adeline. But she never came as he stood motionless in a total weakened state of mind. Dick hadn't mentioned Jacobs's bones when he called the police. He was worried it could potentially distract them away from his main concern. Who knew with the police around there? A story like that would possibly be enough to turn the feller's reputation into a circus overnight, and Dick knew it. Small country towns talked, and on top of that they did it well. It was a lesson learned since a boy, when his friend Bobby Vettenmore accused his mother's boyfriend of being a pee-pee toucher. Ever since then the neighborhood knew him as the touched boy. Dick hadn't thought about that in years. He was only a ninth grader at the time. Sitting at the table, he closed his eyes and thought about what life was like before Julia and Adeline. It was a thought he had never imagined until now, but it almost somehow seemed plausible that very moment. It was a guilty thought as he shook his head in disbelief. That very second his mind turned towards the colonial. What was it with the place? He wondered as he sat quietly listening to his watch tick. He thought about everything that had happened in just a matter of a week and how his family was being torn out from underneath him. Suddenly, he sneezed. The aroma of freshly picked lilacs hit his nostrils. His eyes traced the room outside of the kitchen as he sat baffled. Dick! A breathtaking voice cried into his ear. It was faint and instantly reminded him of his great uncle Riggs. He jumped back, nearly tilting the seat over onto the hardwood. He didn't speak. Fearfully, he walked towards the front doorway. He had heard the ghastly voice, but it didn't quite register to him what it had said. His nerves were spiking at a high as he reached the door, but stood a moment peering into the kitchen. His eyes fixated into the room. It was almost as if the room itself had changed and appeared usually eerie. The cabinetry in the old kitchen appeared even darker and grittier now as he scanned for the unseen voice. The floor stunk of rotten blood and lacked its common shine as he watched through the archway. The scent of dead flowers blew heavily at him as he gawked stubbornly. Shaking his head, not agreeing with any of it, he rubbed his eyes, disbelieving what he had seen and heard. Standing at the door, a sudden terrifying squeal echoed from outside, a blood-curdling shriek. It sent him into a panic as he clutched the front knob and left for his car. Riggs had died when he was still very young, of throat cancer. He carried a breathing tank along since he could remember. The thought of him was new also. It was a memory he didn't fix to remember. He was one of five children that day who had witnessed Uncle Riggs' final moments. Dick could still hear the oxygen fighting through his throat as he spoke, lying in the upstairs of his grandparents' home in South Billington. He died that afternoon, and to Dick Feller the loss of Riggs was more than a tragic moment in his childhood. Riggs had been an older brother to him and taught him everything important. From his lessons on girls, to sports, to surviving in the woods, all of the necessities a young man could ever hope to learn from someone as wise. His mindset was ages ahead of the rest and further than anyone he ever grown close to. Dear Uncle Riggs. Dick Feller stopped as he reached the stairs, pulling the door behind him shut. Outside it was humid and the air felt dry as it reached his face. The night sky was clear overhead and there was stars filling the vastness of its space. Dick dropped down and sat on the ledge of the top step with his legs hanging loosely down. The Doc Martens on his feet had tightened in the heat since returning. He could feel the soreness now circulating through his ankles. He hadn't stopped worrying about Adeline as he sat staring outwards at the dark night ahead of him. There was a wooden fence off to his right in the distance. It led midway into the open field. It was broken down as it stood, leaning along the wild plants sprouting about. His eyes traveled along it as he sat patiently waiting for hope to come back into his life. Julia was still under care at the General Hospital a few miles east of the Colonial. He thought about the baby and Aid as well, but it only hardened his heart more as he sat in the quiet night. To his left side, far out into the night, he watched a car speed along the old highway in the distance. It was making its way around the curvy mountain, and at times it would disappear and reappear from behind the trees blocking him. He watched its headlamps as it traveled hastily in the same direction. It was the only light moving in the darkness as he sat gawking, wondering if they were headed towards the other side of town. Isolation was building up around him as he observed from the highest point of the stone stairwell. The Colonial was now a black statue of hatred barred behind its evil past. Callously behind him, as if almost watching from its evil eye. The Colonial stood behind him, as if mocking him, growling madly behind him. Its deadly historic history, full of tragedy and unmentionable past doings, had dug its presence into the foundation. Still very much alive in some unimaginable way, it continued to scream through the humid night surrounding the property. Its face was cold and its appearance was forbidding, although alluring and mesmerizing at the least. Dick's eyes opened large, two walnut-sized pupils glared towards the driveway ahead of him as a car pulled slowly in. Puddles of stones snapped along the ground underneath its dry rotten tires barely gripping the ground. A red 1963 Ford Falcon came towards the sandstone where he was sitting with an unused cigarette stashed behind his ear. He hadn't lit it, but was at that point of giving in. But, the thought of Adeline at the hospital a night before urged him away until now. The Falcon was spotless and idled smoothly as it came to a sudden stop at the edge of the walkway. Dick could see a man sitting inside, still behind the wheel as if awaiting him to approach and ask why the stranger had come. He watched another moment, but the man remained stationary inside. The nightshade was darkening around the two, although the headlamps illuminated the stairway where he finally pulled himself up to see what the man's business for being there was. Walking straight for the man, the lights blinded him a moment before he reached the driver's side. The window suddenly rolled downwards, sluggishly down until it popped inside the frame. An elderly gentleman peered out at him, reaching his left arm out to greet him. Dick was surprised by the unusual visitor, not recalling having seen him before. "Mr. Feller," called the senior man, who appeared to be in his late 70s, from behind the clear-shined glass. Chapter 5, Relive. They sat drinking black coffee at the table. The creamer can had been empty and Dick hadn't stopped at the local grocery stop to grab any. Julia was still alone in the intensive care unit for her uncontrollable bleeding and suicide watch. Her mind wasn't near where it needed to be, and if she learned about Aid, God could only say. Dick poured the last of it in the ceramic mug Adeline had made in her art class a couple years earlier. It had the words "Love Some" carved into the mold. It was a gift for her father on Father's Day that year. It had her tiny fingerprints casted into the handle as grooves. Dick admired it greatly. It taught him something he hadn't thought about since a child, just how fast time really moves and how fast the maturing level takes over at an early age. 15 minutes had flown by, and still Dick didn't quite know what the man was there for. They had spoken little, he invited him in for coffee figuring he was a relative on his wife's side of the family, but he wasn't particularly worried if he was or he wasn't. He was broken down and needed a moment to clear his mind and spill out whatever it was that was eating at him. The man sat at the corner of the table cross-legged holding the hot mug of Joe. His hair was a wavy light brown. It surprised Dick sitting there across from him just how much hair the older man still had. It was almost miraculous. He had seen younger people with half the thickness of his, and somehow for whatever chance this old man who should be dirt bald had a diamond plate of hair. Bushy eyebrows and a slanted nose, the man sat quietly sipping from the lip of the steaming mug. Wild hair grew from his ears and his skin was badly burned along his Adam's apple, which caused Dick to stare curiously. Not wanting to come off rude or impolite, he fought to keep his thoughts on Adeline and Julia. He awaited the man to bring up the topic. His mind was running on fumes and he didn't feel up to explaining everything without a reason. The senior man's jeans were flared and were tan. He appeared to be a businessman, but he wasn't holding any type of briefcase or clipboard. Good thing, Dick thought to himself. His nerves were shot and he didn't have the strength to toss the man out on his ass. Guessing to himself, the man had arrived for nothing more than an unannounced visit for Julia. She hadn't mentioned anyone to him, but it wasn't too unordinary for her to forget. Her immediate family spread out along the state for the most part, and reunions weren't really a thing for them. But there he was, whoever he was. It didn't matter either way to Dick as he observed how the man handled the stiff mug of brewed coffee. His hands were tight and didn't shake about like most elderly or senior citizens. He controlled his movements well for his age and had a strange confidence about himself as he sat comfortably on the wooden stool. It was as if he hadn't been a stranger to the colonial, or was he? Dick wondered as he glared again at the burns along the elder man's neck region. Questions circled in his brain as he took a brisk sip from the white porcelain mug. "So, Mr. He began to talk, until the man suddenly interrupted his thought. He began coughing ferociously as he rose onto his feet, leaning in towards him. Dick's face went cold, as he watched in helplessness at the man. The man grabbed his neck and held tight against where he had the horrible burns. Almost falling over the table, the mug slipped from his fingers and smacked into the ground below him. Hot coffee splattered along the wooden floor as the mug spun wildly unbroken. "Jesus, sir, do you need an ambulance?" shouted Dick, worried for him. The man shook his hand in an attempt to communicate, but he didn't get his point. Beginning to breathe again, the man peered at him as the blood ran back into his face. "Damn," said Dick, standing now, glaring at the stranger. "You almost gave away in my kitchen. You gave me a scare. Would you like some water instead?" he asked, wondering what had brought the episode on. The man finally opened his mouth as he gazed into his eyes from afar. "You understand you're not alone here, do ya?" he asked. His voice was straining as he bent down for the mug. Dick paused a moment as he listened on the other side. Both sat again as the man's eyes stuck into his like a blazing flame about to explode for the first time on New Year's Eve. An unexplainable darkness swept over the table in front of them as they glared eyes upon eyes under the dim kitchen lamp. The light shining down was a dull yellow and turned the atmosphere into a grim place the more Dick sat watching. His face was now sturdy and pointed at the man as he awaited him to finish. He peered at Dick, watching back. "The dead, you haven't seen them?" he asked. This time his voice became more hesitant sounding. He suddenly slammed his fists onto the kitchen tabletop. The sound of it caused Dick to jump, pushing his chair back away as he listened to him. He could sense his legs going numb as the room became increasingly colder around the two. "No," he said, not explaining the voice he had heard not long before he arrived. The dreadful man glared at him. "You're going to die and your family will follow," he shouted loudly across at him. The whiteness around his eyes appeared black and his temperament had changed since earlier. He was growing desperate and seemed to be paranoid as he glanced around the kitchen at something unseen. He appeared disturbed from the other end as Dick watched cautiously. Sensing the man had a medical condition, he urgently peered from the chair. "I'm sorry, I think you mistaken us, mister. I'm going to show you out now," he said as he rose up and pointed to the doorway behind the man. The elderly gentleman awkwardly stood up and trudged towards the door. His legs were straight and tight as he slowly pulled the door open. He was tall and slim and walked creepily out into the night. His pant legs flared at the bottoms and shook in the stillness of the humid wind as he gawked at him from the doorway, observing his car again. Hitting the bottom step, the man's dress shoes slapped against the rocky ground as he reached the driver's door of the Ford Falcon. Suddenly he turned at him from the driveway and snapped his neck upwards at the room where Adeline had made her safe haven. Dick glared also, wondering what the man was oddly staring at. A second later the man was in his seat and had started the nicely detailed car. From the door, Dick continued to watch him pull around and back out into the old highway. He was off and on his way to nowhere. From what he knew, the visiting man was nobody more than a scared old man. Back inside, he sat at the kitchen to only get up and head up to the second floor bedroom. Adeline's room, he stood in the doorless entrance wondering sickly about her. Her room had the smell of an old woman's coffin, as he rubbed his nose curious of what had caused the upstairs to smell of rank perfume and decaying flowers. What in God's name is going on here? He wondered to himself, standing along the wooden framework. From where he stood, he noticed the wallpaper above her bed was beginning to peel off as if somebody had deliberately done so. It hung downwards on the left-hand side and revealed a nasty dull wall with deep fingernail markings covering most of it. Did the colonial hold a tormented past? Or was there some sort of supernatural timetable of a lost moment playing over and over like a vinyl record beating across a needle? He wondered as the elderly man's voice surfaced unsuspectingly and relayed inside his thoughts the dead, "You will all die and you will follow soon after." Dick Feller spun back towards the hallway and plodded back downstairs. The strong smell of rotten lilacs continued to attach itself to him. He breathed it in as he hit the kitchen once again, pulling a chair out to sit. Peering to the opposite side of the table, the stranger's mug sat unmoved. His daughter's handwriting etched and baked into it glimmered under the dim bell-shaped lamp hanging above. Before reaching for it, he examined it for another moment. The thought of Adeline molding it for him surfaced as he closed his eyes. A moment passed, reopening his heavy lids, realizing he was now alone. The room around him felt oddly heavy. Every time he took in a breath of fresh air, his chest could feel its thickness building walls up against his lungs. The feeling of it reminded him of a time when he was 9 and had almost blacked out. His second cousin Barry had put a pillowcase over his face while playing around in his parents' cellar. It was a close call that afternoon. They were acting out playing Get the Burglar. A game both invented after watching a black and white episode of Superman. It was something they both enjoyed when they came together on random Saturday mornings, but it had become extensively serious after the incident. Barry had moved away that summer not long after. His parents had an offer to live in San Antonio, Texas when his father accepted a promotion. He was appointed as a U.S. military colonel with the Special Operations Unit that August. Dick recalled every detail of it. He hadn't been back after the move. 6 years later, Barry had been killed in Vietnam from an explosion. A U.S. helicopter blade had been dismantled by a missile wound up hitting him, causing the fatal wound to his lower torso. It had punctured an artery, leading to his agonizing death after spending 26 hours in a hospital camp on base. The United States Army awarded him a medal for his bravery, a Purple Heart, but he wasn't fortunate to be alive to accept the distinguished honor in person. His parents generously shipped it by airmail to Dickie that winter. One he would rather forget altogether. Barry's medal hung in his office, encased in a memorable frame since then. At times he would find himself staring up at it in deep thought of his past cousin. Back then, in 1967, most of his family still called him Dickie. It wasn't until he reached senior high before his family and friends managed to give him the masculinity of being called Dick. It suited him better, at least he felt that way. The humiliation of his name was already an atrocity, but since a child it had almost become second nature overhearing perverted jokes. He went to grab the mug but suddenly stopped himself halfway with his arm stretched across the dining table. His eyes took notice of an unusual residue caked around its handle as he watched in curiosity from the other end. It appeared to be clear-like as he fixated on it. The living heaviness around him stemming from upstairs smoothly rolled through as it hit his nostrils once again as he sat on the wooden stool. It tasted bitter as he licked his mouth in total disapproval of the unnatural sensation. Its unwelcoming aroma immediately sickened him inside his stomach as he pulled for his white undershirt. Yanking the neck of it, he pulled it up out from his work uniform, covering his mouth and nose of the pesky smell. His eyes gawked at the hand-grafter mug. Finally gripping it from its position, he held it broadly in his fist. Holding the mug in his hand, he began twisting it, observing the strange substance that had been left. It was unlike any he had ever seen. Lifting it closer, he raised his daughter's mug until it reached his deepened nostrils. Strangely, there wasn't any specific odor from what he could detect. Placing the mug back, he stood up to exit the kitchen, suddenly realizing he wasn't alone. Chapter 6, Sick Thoughts. Peering from the far side of the kitchen through the window, he noticed the same lights as before gleaming in through the glass. The odd man had come back for whatever reason, as Dick stared a moment longer, awaiting the driver's side to open this time, but it didn't. His face drooped, standing there watching out. He was worn down and desperately lacked a subtle night's rest. For a week straight, he had been pulling 16-hour shifts to cover for an injured coworker. He had even slugged through his hour-long lunch breaks because the company was behind on its orders. They had replaced the previous supervisor who was in charge of inventory and had since then hired a newcomer who was being trained from ground up. The only downside about it was they were bumped up in company salary and were now being paid a lucrative amount of money. Much more than what Dick had already made, which had caused a bit of frustration within the boss and him. The younger working generation working there seemed to be thriving at the moment, which agitated him after putting in years of mind-bending hours and overtime. Suddenly, the broad side of the driver's door swung out and a man's leg lifted out onto the gravelly ground. His flared pants waved in the subtle dusk as he stood staring inwards at the colonial. Dick Feller hadn't budged, gawking at the unusual man who had come back for whatever reason. His eyes briskly traced the room, wondering if the man had forgotten something. The strange elderly man began plodding towards the stone stairway leading up to the main door. Dick's eyes caught him moving from in the far window as he stubbornly headed over to greet the man. It seemed as if minutes had passed waiting for the unlikely man to knock, but it never came. He pressed his ear to the blunt door in front of him but could only hear himself breathing in anticipation. The small window was within his eye's reach, but he remained low against it, almost hoping the man would turn back. The first encounter was stifling to him and somewhat disturbing enough that he wanted no parts of another visit. His daughter swept across his mind again as he leaned his shoulder into the heavy storm door of the colonial. Quietly awaiting a sign, nothing came. Another minute had rushed by, still standing just out of view from the kitchen windows by the doorway. Cigarettes crossed his mind as he poked around inside his work pockets, finding nothing but a twisted filter left over from a day earlier. His face sagged lower in turmoil. He lowered down onto the hardwood underneath him, sitting against it in disgust. Peering upwards towards the kitchen, the stranger's headlamps had unsuspectingly shut off and was now nothing but a backdrop into the pitch night. He held the filter in his palm as he wondered deeply inside of his mind, desperately in search of a faint sign that his faith was still there. But inside, his heart felt fractured and it was colder than he could remember. Even the blood flowing through him was nervously afraid at the thought of prayer. There was nothing else left, he felt shattered to unrepair. Suddenly, death cries vaulted through the walls, almost startling him as he leaped onto his legs, staring from side to side of where it originated. The cry abruptly stopped just before he could pin its location. His stomach ached in panic of Adeline as he sprung from the doorway, almost slipping onto his face as he reached the second step leading up to the second floor. He caught himself as he clung to the old lacquered banister. Slowly climbing to the top, he peered from his daughter's room to the bedroom Julia and he shared together. Everything was ordinary and as it was before the strange crying. Pain plundered to the backside of his scalp, suddenly standing along the creaky boards at his feet. A migraine had emerged in the hair-splitting second of desperation of finding aid. He began gripping his fingers into his thinning hair, squeezing until he could feel himself become numb. Leaving the stairwell, he crept down until he came to the refrigerator door. Before opening the double doors, he slightly turned his view back out into the night. The driveway was empty and the shiny car was also gone. The sight of the empty driveway suddenly gave him a sense of peace. It was a mild feeling that reassured him in the slightest way, but it was something he eagerly needed. It was the first for him on such a dreadful evening. Swinging the freezer side of the tall black and silver-handled refrigerator open, he clutched a frozen bag of sweet corn in his gritty fingers. Oil and sludge covered his fingernails from the work plant a day earlier. He pressed the plastic bag against his temple as it stung just a moment until its coldness settled in. The frost felt soothing upright along his whiskered cheek. His beard had grown drastically since a day earlier. Suddenly, he could sense the cold steam rising from the corn as it touched his skin. Awaiting the chilling shriek he had heard moments before, he shut the freezer, leaving the kitchen as he entered into the living room. Finally, his leather boots were off and strewn about, as he sunk into the love seat where Juliana's friend had spent the night. Dick began peering into the kitchen at the phone hanging on its receiver, quiet as ever. It hadn't rang since he arrived home from the general hospital when he reported Abe missing. His only daughter. It chilled him to the bone at the thought of losing his only little girl. It felt like a dramatic movie plot that he couldn't escape no matter how badly he wanted to. The thoughts running across his mind were gut-wrenching. "Dickie Doo, wake up," whispered the slight dying voice of a young child into his ear as he just nodded off. His eyes fought the heaviness as he became alert, peering into the kitchen as if somebody was playing a mischievously game on him. "Who's here? Come out now. Or else," he demanded as his voice echoed into the large home, almost ringing and dying off as quick as he had heard the strange child's. His eyes were still squinting as he gawked about, wondering about the name it had called him. It had called him Dickie Doo. It was a name only one other person had ever called him, and even then it was in an attempt to irritate him in some callous kind of manner. A girl named Shelley Drubblemeyer, a fifth grader he had despised of since moving to Wedgwood Elementary School at the age of six. At the time they had rode the same bus together, sitting on opposite sides until fifth grade when she suddenly died in a terrible accident. As a child he didn't quite grasp what really happened to Shelley, until he grew older and realized the severity of it. Shelley's entire family were all trapped inside: his sister Megan, who was 9, her older brother Frankie, who was 10 going on 11, her mother Betty, and her father Vince Drubblemeyer had all perished that winter in the remarkable blazing inferno. A fire that towered above the whole town, from what he could remember classmates saying after their untimely deaths. That Sunday morning her father Vince Drubblemeyer had accidentally dozing off listening to the Jets game on the old radio receiver he kept beside his miniature beer fridge. It wasn't anything new for him to nap during a game. He had done it at least 500 other previous game days. But this time, the smoldering cherry on his cigarette had fallen off and caught fire. A flame started accidentally that had an entire Christian family in its mind. For whatever unlikely chance, the ashes from the cherry had landed flat on an unnoticed spot of spilt kerosene. The trace detectives wrote it up that way and concluded that it had been accidentally poured months earlier before the house fire. He had sold the kerosene heater for $10 to a local friend a few months prior, but somehow hadn't noticed that the cap had worked its way loose during the transport from the cellar to the garage. "It was a dumb luck maybe," Dick recalled thinking to himself as a small boy. Remembering the day he learned of Shelley's death from a classmate the next morning in Mr. Darden's geometry club. Dark luck it was, the kind of luck kids like Dick Feller ran from. The kind of stupid luck that tells you not to open the door when a stranger's outside and possibly wielding a butcher knife. The kind of luck that causes mass nightmares, the kind that arrives at your front door and begins knocking for you to answer unexpectedly and for whatever dopey reason you open up for it. The thought swirled in his head as he played 30 years back in rewind, trying hard not to miss anything. "Good old Shelley." He conjured up another memory of her as he sunk into the plushy cushions behind him. At first he pictured her face. As always, she had a few pimples on her blushed cheeks. Premature acne, he guessed, as he thought harder laying there. Her hair was neatly braided into two pigtails and crimped between two plastic hair clips and put back as if she was ready for Sunday school. Her face was oily and her eyes were a light sky blue as he remembered her vividly. She even had that red dress on, the one her overly fanatical mother had homestitched for her. That was the week that she had been bullied by some older girls in a grade up from hers. It had taken place in the girls' restroom that afternoon. Toby Rogers, another student who sat across from him in math, had told him, Shelley Dribble Meyer had walked in on a couple of girls trading smokes to each other and gossiping. But, ultimately, the girls bullying her never confessed and blamed it on Shelley's warped wardrobe. Shelley was known as a plain Jane, and somehow that threatened the integrity of the quickly maturing females in her classroom. They made their opinions of her quite noticeable that afternoon by stealing her clothing from her gym locker. The entire day she was forced to wear her smelly gym outfit, and it didn't end any better afterwards. After dismissal, the girls that had swiped her belongings heartlessly waited for her to leave for her bus and pummeled her to the ground. Shelley's mother, who was a devoted worshipper at the Lutheran church, was unimpressed with it all. She went as far as making her own stand against the cruelty taking place on smelly Shelley. It would become a final statement that would hardly be a stand, at least in Shelley Dribble Meyer's case, if she had won. Her mother tirelessly sewed every single shred of clothing for her for the remainder of the fifth grade that year. Actually, for the remainder of her shortened life, to put it logically. Dick lay against the sofa for another moment, releasing a loud yawn, covering his mouth with his arm. He gazed at the wall, suddenly noticing the picture frame turned upwards. In front of him, the photograph was upright, and the photo Julia had snapped that day was lying underneath along the floor by the wall. It had slipped out from the frame. At least at the sight of it, it suddenly appeared that way. His eyes traced the wall as if somebody was standing before him, somebody he was unable to visually see. The wall was bare and had a small spider web resting along the ceiling and itself. It appeared abandoned since spun. Julia hadn't dusted the colonial since their arrival. She wasn't particularly a housemaid. A caring mother. Yes. A maid not even close, Mr. Feller thought about Julia as he watched the growing dust collection forming. He then noticed how dry his mouth had become since resting. Using his hand, he touched his lips, which were easily drier and beginning to split on the corner of his mouth. I could really use a glass of gin, he said quietly to himself, almost hearing his own thoughts outside of his tortured mind. The thought of ice cut perfectly into diamonds shook around inside his mind as if they were his last resort to cure his thirst. The way the liquor shined on them flickered for a moment caused him to almost drool metaphorically. Continuing to watch the ice cubes, they began gyrating inside his warped perception, causing a magical sound. The distinct sound of a cold river spring flowing from a mountaintop. He licked his leathery lips in an attempt to catch the icy liquor flowing beautifully towards him, in relief of his dehydrated mouth. As he did, the ice continued slipping away and further from him, angering him as he grew more disturbed. Suddenly, he opened his eyes again, realizing it was a daydream. A terrible fantasy, one Julia would never forgive if he were to give in again. Alcoholism was a pure demon that had already taken him over once before, and he realized it finally, putting both hands over his face. He wanted nothing more than to wipe the temptations away, find aid, and get back to the general hospital to nurture his wife. But, at the moment, he too was facing a blazing barrel, one that pointed him in the face every time he tried escaping it or every time he felt the urge of regrouping with his family. It pulled him away every time unexpectedly. The colonial had a powerful force growing stronger every second that ticked past. A force of dreadfulness and despair swarmed within its evil structures. It spewed of rotten lilacs, and the smell of death and brutality covered it and its massive property. It was just the beginning, and the Fellers were just a tiny part playing unknowingly in its deadly plans. Plans of its hateful revival and demonic nature were only the start of its hindering habits of killing off its tenants. The colonial was surging under the summer sky and blindly leading its new owners into a dark spiral of negative energy. Its victims would come and go, but never stay for longer than what it would allow. And yes, it would decide when and where. It was a living, breathing travesty, the way it preyed on the innocent. A black knight of sorts. The devil's pawn, described in other words. Lastly, the colonial was what it was, the colonial. It was simple as that.